not here to deny people a right. We're here to fix a wrong. They said it was over. Is it over? We're seeing something unprecedented in our island's history. We're putting aside our personal feelings about politics, our preference for a given political status, our differences in our place of birth, different languages, our differences in many ways, just to unite behind a single cause of tomorrow self-determination. We are the people of Guam who look out for each other, who respect each other, who understood that tomorrow hospitality and the half-a-day spirit was not an invitation to deny fundamental right to choose a political future. We are not dividers. We are uniters. We're not seeking to fight with others. We are promoting peace. That's why we are here arm in arm, step by step, marching, walking in the full view of our ancestors who came before us and are this moment watching us. Maila, come with us. Fanohi, Kahulu, Kalamtin, move forward with one clear voice that will not be silenced, that will be heard here in Adaloo, over there in the federal courts, in Washington, D.C., in New York, wherever there are people who make decisions about us. They must hear the echoes of history, the cries for justice, the voices of the people who are gathered here this beautiful morning. Let them know that you are here. Are you ready? Biba Guahan! Biba Guahan! Nalagang louder, Biba Guahan!
I'd like to call up Mr. Leland Bettis.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here. I want to thank the organizers of the conference for inviting me. It's allowed me to reflect on some very memorable times that I spent, a lot of them very painful. So bear with me as I try to unpack a lot of these experiences. Let me get some obvious framework issues out of the way. We've talked about this a lot, but in negotiations, it's important to note Guam is a colony. Guam's colonial status underlies the colonizer's grasp on power and its opposition to change. The backflips and denial that U.S. law and jurisprudence have taken to preserve this status, the attempts to command the narrative about Guam's status, the exercise of power that reshapes Guam's demography and significant aspects of its economy and land use, these are all demonstrations of colonial power. But colonialism just doesn't exist. It actively destroys. The virus is aimed directly at the colonized. Language, culture, identity are just the most obvious targets. The true force of colonialism is that it attempts to negate resistance to its malignancy, to seduce or coerce, if necessary, the colonized into accepting that colonialism is a norm, is an optimal end state for colonialism. The corrosive effect is so significant that in the struggle against the status quo, even all of the colonized are not down with the struggle. Change begins at home. In a perfect colonial state, there would be no decolonization. Inaction is a colonial enabler. Apathy is the enemy of change. Since the early 1980s, however, the government of Guam has, with some stutter steps, proposed more than just piecemeal changes to the status quo. The plebiscite-approved Guam Commonwealth Act is perhaps the touchstone of these proposals. Commonwealth generated a broad political consensus at home that necessitated the U.S. government paying attention. And even when the Commonwealth process failed in Washington, the Act's Chamorro self-determination provision became the trigger for the decolonization program. Before I move on, there are two things that are crucial to understand about the Commonwealth process. First was the role of non-governmental actors. It is difficult to understate how important the role their role was in shaping the Commonwealth Act itself, and also in plebiscite approval. For those of you that don't know the history, the Chamorro self-determination provision and immigration provisions were advanced by OPIR and ultimately adopted in the process. It is instructive to note that the Guam legislature did not even endorse the Guam Commonwealth Act or the draft act, and didn't take a position on Chamorro self-determination and immigration provisions until a couple of weeks before the second plebiscite. The elected officials were encouraged to take this action as a result of non-governmental pressure. I want to talk about the asymmetric power dynamic that you're going to be faced with. In the process of negotiations with the U.S. government, awareness of the unequal playing field is crucial. If you simply accept colonial power, then you allow colonialism to continue. If you ignore colonial power and ascribe that somehow you are a partner, you are in denial of your status as a possession, even under U.S. law. All the same, the asymmetric power dynamic is real, and it is a steep, steep gradient that change agents must always be cognizant of. In a governmental context, you have to behave like you are serious about change. You need to mobilize all of the resources at your disposal to reflect that seriousness. This undertaking requires constant focus, cultivation, and activism. While none of these actions will actually change the power dynamic itself, it will adjust the process of discussions, and more importantly, will engender some sort of respect for Guam's positions. Another framework issue is that time is not your friend. After 120 years of American colonialism, perhaps this is just too obvious. But think that over 30 years ago, Guam sought to limit immigration. Look at what has happened since then. 30 years ago, Guam wanted to manage temporary labor requirements. And now, even the U.S. standard that applied then have evaporated. Or land. The U.S. government had said it was going to return, has been clawed back. But there are more than these obvious examples. The axiom of the legislative process, that it's always easier to stop change than it is to effect change, is a very real challenge. The less things change, the more they stay the same. And in a colonial context, the same is regressive. If colonialism were a criminal enterprise, then there would be a lot of enablers of this conduct. Moreover, when these enablers are confronted with the nature of the crime, as decolonization advocates must do, the enabler's first reaction is to double down, triple down, quadruple down. After all, they are accessories to a crime that's a century old. Over the past 120 years, Guam has been occupied by three nations with the pretensions of world power. What winds now blow? Because global changes have outsized effects on small island states, watch the swells of geopolitical change and be ready to surf the next wave or risk being crushed by it. Having noted some of these framework issues, allow me to look over some of the key lessons that can be learned from the Commonwealth years, at least from my experience. I will divide my short stories into two categories. First, what experience has taught us about how the U.S. government works in response to Guam's petition for change? And two, how Guam can best prepare to advance its interest in the face of the colonial power dynamic. In 1989, the Guam Commission on Self-Determination was invited to the Virgin Islands by their status commission. And during one of the public sessions we had, one of the members in the audience asked the commission, "So how has Washington received the Guam Commonwealth Act?" The late Senator Frank Santos didn't miss a beat and said, "Well, the Great White Father wasn't exactly at the airport to meet us." Few, if anyone, in Washington is going to be excited about any proposal from Guam for structural change. The absence of a protocol greeting at the airport is just the beginning. There will be courtesy meetings and polite discussions, but without a lot of advocacy from Guam, Washington is not going to advance a change in Guam status. Whether you're working a legislative agenda or pushing an item on the administration, don't expect a U.S. governmental process to be self-effectuating in your favor. In fairness to U.S. officials, the Guam issues are just one of many they have to deal with on a regular basis, and arguably they deal with other issues similarly. The big difference is that even well-meaning Washington officials, even sympathetic ones, and yes, they exist, albeit as exceptions, understand the steep climb that Guam's status represents. Those willing to assist Guam's just cause have few natural allies in the federal system, and there are no power centers in Washington pushing them to pursue Guam's interest. So from the time you land in Washington, you're on your own. It's up to you to push. There is no one that is going to follow up except you. And when you leave, you better know where your next pressure point is. In the end, it might not matter the Great White Father didn't even know you were in town. But working for structural change isn't about a person or personality. Decolonization is not personal, it's structural. One of the other lessons is that the true power centers don't want to engage you directly. Let's face it, there's only one reason the U.S. government maintains a colony in Guam. Clearly, the coaling station requirement of the 19th century is different from the Little Pearl at the end of World War II. The SAC and generally nuclear naval capable operations during the Cold War are the multi-pronged naval aviation C5I capabilities of today. But one thing has always been the same. Guam is a preferred location for offensive military operations. So why aren't the military the ones negotiating with Guam? The Chamorro of Guam, and by that I mean the native inhabitants, as defined by the 1989 Treaty of Paris, received citizenship in 1950 for some civilian purpose? Does anyone really believe that the Chamorros would have received citizenship except for the military interest in Guam? I think my point is clear. For the U.S. military, Guam is a place, it's more than a base, that is an insurance policy in its Asian war planning strategy. It considers that the insurance premiums have already been paid in full. The military arguably has all that they want. So the U.S. government postures to send everyone except the military to negotiate with Guam on its status. Enter the colonial caretakers. The Office of Insular Affairs serves as a coordinating agency for federal agencies and insular advocacy in the federal government. In truth, this is little more than a clearinghouse function with some attendant institutional memory. But no one believes the Office of Insular Affairs is driving State Department, Justice Department, or Defense Department views related to Guam, or that they have the moxie to change the views of those in other departments to accommodate Guam's interest. And yet, the federal functionaries occupying these colonial caretaker roles frequently relish and exercise outsized power. For example, the local and regional representative of the U.S. Department of Justice, Labor, DHS, or EPA are the principal point of contact for their national offices. But they are more than just the messengers to reinforce the limits of federal support and the dependency of Guam's governance. They are also the messengers back up the federal chain of command. And while I'm loath to paint all federal conduit to Guam with the same broad brush, at the end of the day, they really haven't helped change Guam's status. In fact, the message going back up the federal chain frequently serves to reinforce the self-importance of the caretakers in the front line of colonialism. The foil for this self-importance is too frequently a negative projection of Guam. And in many instances, these are regular federal employees, so they stay around for a long time. I should add that the same also exists at the very top end of the U.S. governmental employee ladder among the senior executive service class. It is my observation this group is frequently more realpolitik in their views, so overt racism is somewhat less than at the lower end of the U.S. government employee spectrum, but it's no less colonial. In both cases, these U.S. employees are constant, that is a deep state colonial actor, if you wish, even as U.S. administrations come and go. In some instances, they endure for decades. After a while, they become known amongst their federal peers as the Guam experts. When a Guam leader visits Washington or visits a member of Congress about issue X or Y, where do you think the briefing notes come from? It's an ugly truth that the caretakers leading that are keeping Guam busy at the lowest level of federal interaction frequently sow many bad seeds in Washington. So, be prepared for dirty players, very dirty players, and racist ones too. Again, I want to make sure it's understood that I'm not painting all colonial caretakers with the same brush. On the whole, however, there are too few committed actors who are looking for an alternative to Guam's colonial status. Of course, the existence of the status quo for 120 years is Exhibit A. But there's something more insidious that's going on. The sentiment I'm speaking of is well grounded in the legal history of Guam's colonial status, so allow me to digress for emphasis. The constitutional creation of the status of unincorporated territory for Spanish American War prize is unabashedly racist. I'm not here to debate this fact. Go read the Insular cases. Read the contemporaneous law review publications. Look at the cartoons we saw yesterday. But let me make this point clearly. For all intent and purposes, the carving out of status of possessions that are not a part of the United States pivoted around the Commerce Clause of the U.S. Constitution and initially whether sugarcane from newly acquired territory could be admitted into New York without duty. The Supreme Court said that the Commerce Clause of the Constitution arguably the bedrock of the Union of 13 States, which is built around its commercial links, did not apply to the exotic island territories. There are so many layers here that I don't have time to get into, but at the heart of the matter, sugar cane from the Caribbean and the Pacific were seen as competition to the domestic sugar of the American South. Although the U.S. Supreme Court as a whole participated in the creation of the new colonial status for Spanish territorial acquisitions, the leading advocate was Justice, later Chief Justice, White. I'm not kidding. Justice White was a former Confederate soldier from Louisiana, which was then the leading sugar-producing state at the time. And who was responsible for cultivating and harvesting all the sugar in Louisiana? Former slaves and indentured servants of a decidedly dark complexion in the Jim Crow South, who were so poorly treated that their life expectancy was significantly truncated. And for any of those interested, the New York Times 1619 Project had a very interesting piece on this very group of people. I want to underscore the point about the implicit racism of unincorporated territory. Many of the justices of the Supreme Court that created this status beginning in 1901 were also in the court when the separate but equal doctrine of American apartheid was created in 1895 in Plessy versus Ferguson. And yet, just as the Supreme Court in 1954 was approaching undoing Plessy versus Ferguson in Brown versus Board of Education, the U.S. government finally got around to calling Guam an unincorporated territory. Fast forward. In response to Guam's call for self-determination and self-government, be prepared for an ugly, even racist response. From experience, I can tell you that U.S. officials tasked with negotiating Guam's status frequently ran into what they described as the ugliest, most racist diatribes they'd ever witnessed in their government careers. For a quick retrospective, the Guam Commonwealth Act was first introduced by the Bush administration in 1989, and a Bush administration task force on Guam, BATFOG, was headed by a Deputy Assistant Secretary of Interior. The response was basically an assertion of the colonial status quo. BATFOG 2 was Defense of the Status Quo, the sequel. When the Clinton administration came into office, the Commission on Self-Determination called for a special representative to coordinate a U.S. government response. We got that. Two special representatives served over the coming years. In both cases, it is my estimation that the special representative saw the justice in Guam's cause and attempted to affect federal policy to that end. They both described their roles as coordinating a federal response that would provide for Guam's self-government. Not surprisingly, there were a lot of people in the colonial system that didn't like this. I'd be happy to go into more detail offline, but at the end of the day, as the second Clinton administration came into office, it appeared that the colonial caretakers, those who had resisted change for so long, thought they were about to get rolled. At this point, the policy debate ended, and things turned ugly. Unfortunately, Guam got crushed in a disinformation campaign that included use of the U.S. media, with the views of unnamed Justice Department officials and other federal officials painting Guam as corrupt and not worthy of more government than it already had. Many of the ugliest views that I've heard about in this process were actually expressed to the U.S. Special Representative while they visited U.S. employees in Guam. Unsurprisingly, some of these same views were expressed by senior officials in Washington. When a friend of mine approached a friend of theirs who was a very senior official in the Justice Department about meeting the governor of Guam at a political event, the refusal was caustically imbibed with a declaration that Guam was a cesspool of corruption. By the way, the governor in question was never indicted for anything. Even amongst the evidence of indicted Guam officials, I've always been troubled. For disclosure, I admired Governor Berdalio, even if I was not always in the same political tribe. Without prejudice to his innocence or guilt in a colonial court, in a contemporary context, the U.S. ambassador to Micronesia from 1982 to 1987, Fred Zeter, was described by the Washington Post as, quote, a businessman in ambassador's clothing, end quote. This came to a head around the IPSCO power plant deal in Balao, in which he was intimately involved. In addition to questionable guarantees he made to the company about setting up business in Palau, he and his wife got hosted at the British Open by the soon-to-be bankrupt British entity, with Palau left holding the bag. Official U.S. investigations occurred by the GAO and Congress, but the same U.S. Department of Justice that prosecuted Ricky did nothing. Nothing happened to Ambassador Zeter. Ricky, on the other hand, was headed to jail. I can tell you that very few politicians in Guam at the time, even those that were not supporters of Governor Berdalio, viewed his indictment as anything less than a warning against Chamorro nationalism. I think it's testament to where they were and testament to community support that things with the organic, the Commonwealth Act proceeded later. The dark taint of corruption, a proclaimed inability of the natives to govern themselves, and an ascription of racial inferiority is frequently among U.S. employees and U.S. officials the end around for a serious discussion about colonial policy. It's their defense in the face of being called out for their colonial crimes. Of course, we know that they will lose the debate over justice and rights, so they retreat to a racist diatribe. Their retreat to a racist diatribe should not be really unexpected. After all, that's where the status of unincorporated territory began. Prepare to advance your interest. After all I've said, you might say, why bother? So your mission, from a small speck of land in the world's largest ocean, as a people that are a true minority, is to get the world's richest and most powerful country of the age to break the colonial ties that bind. There are a lot of your peers who are ready to give up. Indeed, some already have. They will pretend that being American is a forever bond and the Great White Father will protect them. So why bother with decolonization? Well, no one else is going to tell your story. No one else will respect and protect your land. Your ancestors' spirits and your graves can only be protected by your actions. Without you, your language will become unspoken. Without you, your people will be forgotten. Oh, and by the way, given Guam's status as an unincorporated territory, the Great White Father can dispose of your island, arguably even your citizenship. You can pretend all you want, but a possession is chattel, no matter how much denial any party wants to engage in. If you don't represent your interest, no one else will. So get on the same page. When representing the interest of Guam, there is no substitute for unity of purpose, and this is not easy. It requires working together when the differences are personal, partisan, and even over tactics and strategy around the central purpose. On the other hand, you can be assured that if you don't get on the same page, your interests are going to be picked apart, your momentum stalled, and your old enemy time is going to be tearing away at the fabric of yourself. If you find common ground and common purpose through community support and governmental leadership, then many of the processes which look difficult today will become more easily realized. Whether it's cultural, philosophical, environmental, or financial, bringing community focus to the cause will create its own momentum. As was the case during the quest for Commonwealth, at one point, you know, leaders of both parties worked together, no doubt. But at one point, we had members of the Commission on Self-Determination who traveled frequently together who were running against each other for governor. And yet, the resources to drive the campaign were deeply embedded in the political system and processes. You've got to be prepared to give the messengers their due. If the principal U.S. interest in Guam, as evidenced by land taking, is hiding behind a civilian shield, then the messengers should be treating accordingly. I'm not suggesting that they not be engaged, but rather they be given the deference they are due. They are messengers. Treat them as such. It's not just a civilian shield that puts distance between you and the center of colonial interest. Even the military, perhaps especially the military, sends messengers to quell the discourse. It's a basic negotiating strategy. Recognize it for what it is. If the lowest level messenger can keep the natives from restlessness, then preserving colonial interest is done cheaply. Do you think it's any coincidence the Navy has sent its scare stash of minority and women admirals to JRM? Don't believe me. This is what how JRM describes themselves on their website. Joint Region Marianas, mission is to provide executive level installation management and to act as an interface between Navy and the civilian community to ensure compliance with all environmental laws and regulations, safety procedure, and equal opportunity policy. That's their job. JRM are not war fighters. They are not planners. Their main job is to mollify the locals while providing a bed for training activities. Their job is to keep civilian military decisions, both Navy and Air Force, local, so they don't have to be addressed at some higher regional level or GASP, even the Pentagon. Recognize this. Respond accordingly. It's your job to make the messenger come to terms with the fact that you understand their role and that your objective is bigger than their role. It's not personal. It's professional. It's policy. To recognize a messenger as more than a messenger is to elevate their status and diminish yours. At the end of the day, when the messenger finally realizes you understand the ruse, will they respect you more or less? Does empowering the messenger garner more respect than if you make it clear this is my island? Does playing into one Guam propaganda garner more respect than if you make it clear Tonu Ichimoru comes first? This is not an easy track. This is not an easy track at all. There's going to be tension, a lot of tension, especially when you break the colonial messenger paradigm. On the other hand, if you pretend that the lowest level messenger in the federal is the final arbitrator of colonial policy, then you're not even in the game. Good cop, bad cop, hot potato, whack-a-mole. In the good cop, bad cop routine, beware of colonial caretakers that provide a solution to problems created by other colonial caretakers. The good guys are too frequently just part of the problem. To use a contemporaneous example, while the regional representatives of the U.S. Department of Labor in 2018 realized a long-held objective of cutting off temporary labor to Guam, the bad cop, along comes JRM to provide help, playing good cop. But who benefits the most when Guam's economic development is threatened? What leverage does the threat to Guam's economy provide colonial interest? And what price does the good cop expect from Guam, and in this case also in the Northern Marianas, from helping get around the bad cop in the colonial system? Does the good cop expect that in return for help on labor, that environmental issues, the Texan and Pagan, or the quid pro quo? I think this example makes clear my earlier point about dealing with messengers. If you think negotiating with either the bad cop or the good cop messenger is going to result in any substantive change, then you're definitely on the colonial reservation. If you want to effectuate change, neither of these people are the ones you should be discussing your needs, requirements, and rights with. The long story point here is not just to avoid the honeypot. The more important thing is to stay focused on your objective and not be distracted by the small games. And in a riff on this refrain, beware of the hot potato play at the policy level. Remember, colonial policy is always winning when it remains the same. So don't be surprised when all kinds of people in Washington believe your concerns are legitimate, but it's just not their job. How many times do congressional parties encourage Guam to get the administration's views first and Congress will take them up? How many times have administration officials claimed that the interest Guam is raising can only be resolved by an exercise of congressional power? Then, of course, there's the many varied versions of whack-a-mole. One variation is the whole process of returning excess lands. It's excess to a self-selected military requirement, but wait, it can't be returned until all of the federal agencies have decided whether or not they want to bite at the apple. Meanwhile, large chunks of excess land that have not been returned to Guam and even declared excess by the DOD have been clawed back. More importantly, while there's all this scramble for excess lands, so much of Guam's lands that are held by the U.S. government are unused or desecrated in ways that are an offense to those that have gone before. So what are you going to do? You've got to seek out everyone that can help expand your interest. I know I'm going to sound contradictory here, but bear with me. It's important to build relationships with anyone who can help you expand Guam's interest or help you better understand where the roadblocks are being erected. I would include in this set low-level U.S. government officials, all the way to senior members of an administration, members of Congress and congressional staff with oversight in any of the areas of interest to Guam should be a part of your expanding network of contacts. But just to be clear, the focus of this engagement is to advance Guam's interest, not be distracted by colonial caretakers attempting to carry out a federal interest. There is progress to be made here, even if it is just getting a better understanding of where the roadblocks are being erected. But there can also be breakthroughs when enough focus is brought to the subject by parties who are interested enough to engage in an honest dialogue. By way of example, I remember when Senator Tom Harkin was passing through Guam on his way to observe the decolonization vote in East Timor. As we discussed Guam's status, he asked me the familiar briefing book question was something like this. What's this Chamorro self-determination thing about? Doesn't that violate the rights of other Americans? But he immediately got it when I put the Chamorro right in the context of East Timor, asking him how the U.S. government would feel about a decolonization vote in East Timor that allowed Indonesia to send immigrants that were allowed to vote. the hard truth here is that if you are for statehood, a free association advocate, or an independista, you're going to have to deal with the U.S. government in varying degrees to achieve your desired status. Again, the focus is to develop a rapport around Guam's interest. There's a lot of work, and every subject of your attention is not going to get it. But you have to strip away the misinformation and dirty tricks that are embedded in the colonial discourse. Get to an honest discussion about Guam's interest and the way in which U.S. interest may, or may not, be accommodated by Guam. That brings me to the role of the United Nations. Clearly, this is a legitimate arena in which to pursue relationships, and a place where Guam's decolonization interests are already understood. It is an important pressure point to cultivate stripping away the facade of the lies of the colonial powers tell themselves and others about their subjects. I want to dwell on the UN just a moment because it's so important in the level set about Guam's status. First, Guam has international personality. If the government of Guam asks to be heard, protocol demands that the subjects of an administering power be heard. Second, the customs and convention of international law around decolonization are similar to what you feel in your gut and what you know is right. Even if you didn't know international law was on your side. For example, how many supporters of immigration control, intramural self-determination knew before the vote in 1987 that administering powers were explicitly instructed to limit immigration into territories because it caused demographic disruption, and that this demographic disruption made the legitimate exercise of self-determination more difficult? To me, there's something beautiful about what your gut tells you is just, even when you might not be aware that international law is already on your side. And just to underscore a point that was made earlier by Dr. Natividad and Dr. Corbin, networking in your region to build up a base for the international support is critical. Again, the point here is finding places where your interests will be received well. Cultivate them. Never go hat in hand. Never be apologetic about your rights. Flush out the lies and the liars that obstruct a reconciliation with the truth about Guam's status. Build relationships that are based on understanding and, where possible, mutuality of interest that recognizes Guam's interests first. Empirical, consistent truth-telling. As you work to win friends and influence people, you need to let the facts hang out. Too much of the discussion of Guam in the quarters of power in Washington and even in the UN are conducted by people who are not from Guam. And from experience, I can attest that too frequently the representations about Guam are misleading at best and frequently just outright lies. So your sword in this battle is not just how right your cause is, but how right you are on the facts. Of course you have a right to be emotional and pissed off, but that will not undo the disinformation campaign that is going on in the background. And once you have your evidence, is it on self-government, who's entitled to self-determination in Guam, land return, environmental issues, labor issues, economic development, you must stay on message and be persistent. The people you are trying to win over live in an ADHD world, and more often than not, when they hear about Guam, they're usually receiving a different view from the one of the people of Guam. The United States Studies Center at the University of Sydney just last month published an interesting report called Averting Crisis, U.S. Defense Spending, Deterrence, and the Indo-Pacific. For anyone interested in an extremely anxious, even nervous, allied third-party view of the U.S. military posture in the region, I would encourage a read. For a taste, the lead sentences from the executive summary are this. America no longer enjoys military primacy in the Indo-Pacific, and its capacity to uphold a favorable balance of power is increasingly uncertain. Over the next decade, the U.S. defense budget is unlikely to meet the needs of the national defense strategy, owing to a combination of political, fiscal, and internal pressures. America has an atrophying force that is not sufficiently ready, equipped, or postured for great power competition in the Indo-Pacific. A strategy of collective defense is fast becoming necessary as a way of offsetting shortfalls in America's regional military power and holding the line against rising Chinese strength. On this last point, it's significant to note, as I mentioned earlier, that the government of Australia has already taken steps away from the type of collective defense that this report recommended. But of course, the Aussies were here just last month for Hydra Crab on EOD training. Careful observers will note that in one of its releases, JRM said this about that activity, and I quote, "The island of Guam is no stranger to war, and exercising on former and potentially future battlefields prepares our forces for challenges of tomorrow." Get your head around that. Then, of course, we all know about the Korean threat. Then there's the Chinese intermediate range missile, the DF-26, the Guam Express, as it's called, also known as the Guam Killer. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, except to make the point that the neighborhood is a dangerous place. Finally, let me say that I remain optimistic. I'm sure there were 1,000 times in Guam's history when many determined it was too late. I heard this in 1987 around the Commonwealth Act and, you know, the vote for Chamorro self-determination. After the last Chamorro of the Spanish era expired, the Chamorro people continued to exist. During the depths of the Japanese occupation, a period in which the Chamorro people probably were physically hungry for the only time of their lives in their history, things must have looked really, really dim, but they survived. When the acculturation of the American period sought to eliminate the language, the Chamorro continued, as does a connection to the land, even when large amounts have been taken. Colonial subjects, longer than any other people on the face of the earth, Chamorros will survive as a decolonized people. There are many challenges and many opportunities, but as you look forward, the future must be navigated with your eyes wide open. Sijus Masi.
What are the colonial interests in Guam? To my mind, there's only one interest, and it's related to control of property to project military force in the Asia-Pacific region. So that's the interest, right? You have the caretakers on the other hand. And as much as possible, the people that have the interest are hiding behind what I'm calling a civilian shield of the federal government, right? Don't shoot me, shoot my civilians. I'm sending those out to deal with you. The issue of Chamorro self-determination is really not that hard to understand once you get beyond the sort of reflexive response that, oh my God, Americans are being disenfranchised. There's ways to do this. So my suggestion is, you know, be empirical about this process, be honest about this process, recognize that there's a lot of disinformation in the system about whatever issue you're dealing with, and try to strip away as much of that as you can. One of the special representatives in meetings with officials here in Guam, federal officials here in Guam, was exposed to what was described as the most racist vitriol that he'd ever experienced in his governmental career about Chamorros. And it wasn't just the word Chamorro that was used in this discussion with a federal official. His response was, your job is to go get the corrupt officials, right? If you're at the FBI, go get them. That's your job. My job is to find a way to get self-government for Guam in the federal system. You do your job, I'll do mine. Don't tell me how to do my job. But the point is that this narrative of corruption is one that's used as an attempt to bypass the debate. You don't have to talk about self-government for Guam if you can get enough people to believe that Guam is too corrupt to govern itself, that it needs someone to manage its governance. So the corruption narrative is very, very real, and it's real across a broad spectrum, from, you know, the top level, everybody in Guam is corrupt, to like people on food stamps are corrupt. They're buying lobster with food stamps. Oh my God. So it's a very common narrative and very much part of that polluted information system about what Guam is.
In the Leland's presentation, it reminded me, one, we've always been close friends, but it's been a while since I have had a chance to sit down with him and talk about these issues. And I missed him the past couple times that he's come to Guam. I also thought about 20 minutes in that as the only person up here who's served in the executive branch of the federal government that attacks on the Department of the Interior, I might need to talk to Leland about that a little further. It may have been the case in the past, I'm not going to question it, that there that the Office of Insular Affairs probably had been seen as a caretaker, as one that was not seeking to change policy, but to maintain the status quo. I would argue, however, that after Bush, after Bush II, when President Obama was elected into office, and you started seeing the appointment of Native people into the position of Assistant Secretary, myself, my successor, Ms. Kiaina, and also currently Doug Dominich, who's from who's of Puerto Rican descent, that there's actually not a caretaker mentality in that office, and that it has begun to change, and that other agencies look to them and look to the office and that political leadership to make determinations of federal policy as they apply to the territories. They don't always listen, of course, and that's just the nature of a large bureaucracy like the federal government. But I think in knowing who my, knowing what I was able to accomplish, knowing what Ms. Kiaina was able to accomplish and the priorities that she set as a political leader in the department, and then my current experience as the governor's chief of staff interacting with the Trump administration, I have no doubt that the office has been able to move forward and is seen differently than it had been probably in the 90s, 80s, and the 70s. My experience, for those of you who don't know, I know that Kevin gave a very brief background. I had the opportunity to gain experience on Capitol Hill as a result of this man to my right, Mr. Underwood, who brought me to Washington, D.C. in 1998, which is really where my career began. And I stayed in his office, in his personal office, for about a year and a half before moving to the committee, the House Natural Resources Committee, as professional staff, where I spent the next 11 years before moving on to the Obama administration. During that time, as professional staff on the committee, and also working with Ms. Kiaina, we were like tied at the hip, Esther, because she was Mr. Underwood's chief of staff. There's a lot of work that we did with political status on Puerto Rico. And not that a lot was accomplished, but certainly a lot of work was done. And a lot of conversations and negotiations and putting together legislation that would provide them the opportunity to have or to seek having a vote that had some federal recognition behind it. A gentleman by the name of Jeff Farrow, who was a predecessor of mine on the committee, but many years beforehand. And for those who have been in this game of political status, will know the name Jeff Farrow. He was at the White House during the Clinton years. And he managed to get some legislation into, I think, the Department of Commerce's appropriation. Sometimes on Capitol Hill, you, or in Washington, D.C., you hide language in order to get an outcome. You bury it, right? You bury it into something larger that no one, that people will care about, but they'll care about for other issues. And I guess Jeff found that burying some language within Commerce's appropriations clause that would actually provide some federal funding to Puerto Rico, and then I believe have the federal government have to be responsible for the outcome, to be able to respond to the outcome of a plebiscite was something unique. I don't think that it ever actually was implemented. But it was interesting nonetheless as a political legislative strategy. I was on the tail end when I got there of Guam's Commonwealth Draft Act. And so I can't recall, Mr. Underwood, how much work that we did on Guam's Commonwealth Draft Act towards the late 90s. I believe our focus shifted in large part to trying to resolve war claims, which of course we know took overall 36 years to pass and is still waiting for resolution. As professional staff, I was also responsible for interacting with the freely associated states and having oversight hearings from the Natural Resources Committee. And then in 2003, worked on the renegotiated compact and worked on it from the standpoint of Congress hearing it and then approving the renegotiated agreement between the RMI and FSM, which extended it out to 2023. And at that time in 2003, I just never thought that we'd be thinking about that you have to renegotiate the compacts in 2023. It's interesting now when you talk about Guam and the recent court decision where the Ninth Circuit has ruled against Guam in carrying out its plebiscite for Native inhabitants. I know that Governor Leon Guerrero is committed to moving forward, as is the commission, to try and find a path forward in order to hold a vote. And it's something that has resurrected within the community a sense of importance, because when we talk about political status and our identities, we're reminded in times like this, when you have the federal government or an apparatus of the federal government say that you can't do what you know you want to do, and that you know that you're entitled to and you have a right to do it, they tell you you can't do it because of the laws that are in place that end up restricting you from moving forward and not being able to carry out what I think we all know is inertly something that is our right to do as a Native people. I have a personal perspective when it comes to political status. I think that when you talk about the federal relationship, and you think about what can be done within those federal constructs, we know that we know that the U.S. government has colonies, and we know that they have relationships with federal tribes, or with tribes that have federal recognition, Native American tribes. And in some measure, there's always an effort, although be it small, that Guam should maybe seek federal recognition as a Native tribe. And that, in and of itself, the process to do so is a difficult one, because you need to be able to demonstrate that you have a long, decades old, if not hundreds years old, of operating a government. And when the federal government, when the U.S. government says you should have an operating government, they don't mean the government of Guam. They mean that there should have been a Native government in place. And I don't think that in any of the U.S. territories, that's something that can be proven. The other way around that is to seek federal legislation that would provide recognition. And I don't think that has been accomplished for many decades, to be able to legislatively recognize a federal tribe. When it comes to the territories, there are many things that I think that Leland said that is correct, but I think some things have changed. From my point of view, during my time in the federal government, and it continues today, I don't believe that the federal government has any sort of sound policy when it comes to developing U.S. territories and being responsive to the plight, the economic plight most especially, of U.S. territories. There's absolutely no economic policy that they follow. They ask us to do more with less, and they hold us to the same standards as those who have been integrated into the union. And when I say they ask us to do more with less, we know some of the issues. Earned income tax credit is something that we have to pay for. The formula for Medicaid is higher than that of a state, although our needs are greater than most states, and our poverty levels are much lower than those states. Yet we're held to the same standard, if not higher. And I think legislation that's currently being contemplated in Congress, when they have since they have come back for their fall session, there might be a tweak with respect to how Medicaid will operate in the territories. But I understand that there's a consideration that the reporting requirements for U.S. territories will be even more stringent than that of U.S. states. So again, you're held to a higher standard, and you hope that you'll be able to gain from a new formula. During my time back in D.C., actually more when I'm out here now, and since I've come back home, I think I'm often asked, what's the key to moving Guam's agenda forward, whether it's a Guam's federal agenda or Guam's political status agenda. What's the key to doing those things? And part of it is you have to be able to work with what you have, and you have to be smarter than who you're working against. You have to be able to have those sorts of relationships both within the network that we have established here and people who care about these issues, and also the network that will end up causing the network that will have an effect on how you want to change or if you're prepared to change your political status. It's a big thing, self-determination and changing political status. There's a lot of unknowns, and everyone fears the unknown. But it shouldn't stop you from wanting to change. And for those of us here, that's what we're trying to find as the path forward. For those who are watching and listening, we're trying to gain their interest on why we need to move forward. I had a colleague of mine back in D.C. who said that the reason why status quo is not an option when you are trying to exercise your self-determination is because you can't choose to be a slave. And for the most part, when you're a colony, you're likened to that sort of thing. So no matter what benefits that we've seen from being a U.S. territory, and all territories have seen some sort of benefit with respect to their economies or the development of their society or the programs that are in place to help raise everyone's lot in life, it's nonetheless status quo is not an option when it comes to self-determination, because you're not able to exercise that you want to be integrated into the union or that you want to start making decisions as an independent and making a decision of whether or not you want to freely associate with another state. But we have to have that sort of courage to change, and we just have to be smart about it. And it's one of the things that when you are trying to go through your daily grind, your Monday through Friday, and then spend time with your family on the weekends, it's hard to think about political status. It's hard to think about what will happen if Guam is independent, or if Guam is freely associated, or if Guam becomes a state? What am I going to do when I lose my if I lose my U.S. passport? Will the military leave, or can I start charging the military billions of dollars for occupying my property? You know, it's hard to think about those things, but nonetheless, it's important to think about those things. And there may have been a time and a place that the path was a little bit easier. It could have been back in the late 1980s or in the 70s. In the 80s, when there was a vote, where there was a plebiscite vote, and the people of Guam had voted that they respected the right of native inhabitants, and at the time, Chamorros, to be able to exercise their self-determination. True, a lot has happened since then. The world has changed. It's obviously a different place, and it may be harder now to be able to exercise that vote. Do we ask ourselves, do we have to go back to the electorate to ask them the permission to have a vote for a self-determination that respects the rights of the indigenous people or native inhabitants? Or do we keep marching forward and try to find the right path to be able to do that at minimal doesn't get us in trouble ironically enough, with the U.S. court system and the federal government and the laws that we have to live under. It's a very unique and interesting, complex situation. But it's the reason why, again, we come together and we put our heads together and we talk to each other to try to find that path forward. It's really the only way that you're going to ever achieve something meaningful. It's the only way you're going to be able to achieve lifting the lives of people that you care about, your families, your communities, your villages. Because you have to be smarter than everyone else. You have to, you just really have to be smarter. It's almost that simple. You have the heart to do it. You have the passion. But it has to be backed up by how well you know your subject matter and how well you can navigate the myriad of obstacles that are in front of you. But it's not insurmountable. And it's clearly not insurmountable when we're able to get together like this and think about these issues and then go on from here and talk about these issues with our with members of our family and friends. And just to go back to Leland's criticism of the office and of the Interior Department, it was when I was in office that we actually gave money to Guam to be able to move this issue forward, to start an educational campaign. And I believe that the office, if I'm not mistaken, is also going to be doing the same thing for the Virgin Islands. And actually, at the time that I was in office, it was Donna Christensen from the Virgin Islands that introduced legislation that authorized the office, even though we thought we had the administrative authority, to authorize the office to give money for political status education. Because as far as I was concerned at the time, my goal was to move the islands forward and try to have strong policies so that the office no longer existed. Because we realized what the perception of the office. But the office in and of itself, its goal should be to extinguish itself at some point in the future, not to perpetuate itself, because it's not a colonial master. It's not an overseer. It's not a clearinghouse. So I hope my perspective from my years of experience was helpful within the context of this conversation. I thank you very much for the opportunity and look forward to answering any questions.